Well, as we get toward the Word, what a great thing having testimonies this morning. That's just encouraging, right? I want to just to remind you again, I don't want to do the announcements again, but would you just be mindful of what's coming up? We got a lot coming up soon. One thing we probably didn't mention this morning was our Bible college starting on Thursday, September 1st, which is not this Thursday, is it? I think it's the following Thursday. Or am I wrong? No, it's the following Thursday. So that's coming up real quick. We've got several signing up. If you'd like to get signed up, you need to see Peggy. Raise your hand, Peggy, and she will hook you up with the registration. It is $100 per semester, not per class. That has been back and forth. It is per semester. It is very cheap. However, it needs to cost you something or you won't appreciate it. And that is just the truth of how things work. If you don't have the $100 right away, don't let money keep you from getting your Christian education. We'll work out payment arrangements on that. But looking forward to that. And of course, again, men's ministry meet and greet this Saturday. Looking forward to that. Dan, by the way, we have a database of names that you might want to, if you don't already have, we can get a hold of everybody personally as well for that. So remind me. I'm going to get into the Word this morning, but not before I tell you, I'm glad you're here and I love you. How's that? We shouldn't take each other for granted. We shouldn't take your attendance here for granted. We shouldn't take our breath today for granted. And sometimes it's good to just stop and say, thank you, Lord, for how good you are. Thank you, Lord, for meeting our needs. Thank you, Lord, for supplying our needs. And man, I am just glad and excited that you're here today. I don't think we're breaking any of the attendance barriers today. I think that's probably last bit of summer, I'm going to go to Disney one more time. I'm going to go to the beach one more time. I'm going to go see Grandma one more time. Literally, my wife is off seeing Grandma right now, so that's why she's not here. She'll be back Tuesday along with Sam and Pat Pavlak. I'll be glad to get all of those kind of times over. You know, the Beach Boys song, what is that one? The preacher likes it cold. He knows you're going to stay. He knows I'm going to stay. California Dreaming. Always that line in that song always sticks out in my mind. I snicker when I hear it too. Yeah. I like it whenever, school gets back in and things get back to normal and people get back into the house of the Lord. Did we serve our visitors today, Peggy? Did we get those? Thank you if you're visiting with us today for the first time. Welcome, and thank you. I think we got a couple brothers from Brazil back here, is that right? Awesome. Friends of Michael Lane, and I'm glad you're here. Welcome. I heard just great things in the Rio, Brazil Olympics this time has focused a lot of attention on that country and just been, man, I watch the Olympics just to watch the scenery of Rio de Janeiro as they're doing the aerial flights through. What a beautiful country. The work of the Lord is going mightily, mightily there. There are, this has nothing to do with my message. This is just for free. I haven't talked to these gentlemen, but I understand that there are just the Assemblies of God. I happen to know the statistics for the Assemblies of God Church in Brazil. They have 60 million, if I understand. No, 6 million. 66? I don't know. I guess I should get my statistics straight. Way outstretching. There are about 2 million adherents to the Assemblies of God in the United States, and if I understand correctly, there's about 60 million there. I don't know, but it is just an amazing, amazing thing that God is doing around the world. Brazil has become one of those amazing hot spots for God's revival. As you remember, of course, South Korea became one of those major hot spots for revival. The largest church in the world still is in South Korea. God is doing amazing things around the world and will not be limited by communism. It will not be limited by poverty. It will not be limited by religion. It will not be limited by geography, and certainly will not be limited by whether or not they're doing it like the Western American missionary model would have them do it. But God is raising up churches around the world to bring glory and praise to His name. And when we praise and glorify Him, as you were doing in the service this morning, it is our job, our turn to bring praise and glory and honor to His name, and I love doing that. Man, I hope you do too. Well, make sure and invite some of your friends and bring them in. Thank you for those of you who have, and if you've been here invited by somebody else, we're glad you're here. I'm going to get into the Word this morning. Preaching our way through the New Testament, puts us right now in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And today's message is going to be, it's one of those subjects that's harder for us pastors to teach, especially in this modern age in which we live, because it touches on issues that are potentially inflammatory to people who want to take offense at them. But I don't want to do that. I don't want to offend anybody, but I mostly don't want to offend the Lord. Amen? That's a good place to say amen. Thanks for your support. We're behind you, Pastor, but we're waiting to hear what you say first. Well, I'm going to make probably several different groups of people uncomfortable, probably make some women uncomfortable, probably make some men uncomfortable, make some religious people uncomfortable, people from traditional faiths uncomfortable. I'm just going to make everybody uncomfortable. I texted my wife this morning and said that I was going to be preaching on this chapter, and she said, it's okay, I'll come preach for you next week and straighten everything out. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, and I just pray in Jesus' name that you would bless it as we go forth. I pray that you would help us to listen, Lord, even under the unction of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for faithful hearts, Lord, who love your word and have decided, Lord, that we will obey your word above all things, and that we esteem your word as more important even than our food, as the psalmist said. I pray, Lord, you just fill me with your spirit, helping me to operate in the gifts of the spirit, Lord, in the prophetic word, Lord, and in teaching. And we thank you, Lord, that our ears are open to hear the spiritual revealed things of the word of God that the natural man cannot receive. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, Paul, starting in chapter 11, starts right off by saying, imitate me just as also I imitate Christ. Now, I'm going to, you know what? I'm going to read all the way through verse 16. We're not going to get any farther than that today, and I'm going to come back and do them one at a time. It says, verse 2 says, now I praise you, brethren, that you remember me in all things and keep the traditions just as I have delivered them to you. But I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of every woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonors his head. But every woman who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered, dishonors her head, for that is one and the same as if her head were shaved. For if a woman is not covered, let her also be shorn. But if it is shameful for a woman to be shorn or shaved, let her be covered. For a man indeed ought not to cover his head, since he is in the image and glory of God, but the woman is the glory of man. For man is not from woman, but woman from man. Nor was man created for the woman, but the woman for man. For this reason, the woman ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. Nevertheless, neither is man independent of woman, nor woman independent of man in the Lord. For as woman came from man, even so man also comes through woman. But all things are from God. Judge among yourselves, is it proper for a woman to pray to God with her head uncovered? Does not even nature itself teach you that if a man has long hair, it is dishonor to him? But if a woman has long hair, it is a glory to her, for her hair is given to her for a covering. But if anyone seems to be contentious, we have no such customs, nor do the churches of God. Did anybody detect any landmines in there? Okay, I'm just going to walk through and let them blow up, and I'm going to trust that you love the Lord and me enough to if you're offended, that you would go and pray to the Lord about that, and that if you would have an open heart to all these things. There's many things. I'm just going to just run through them. I'm just going to start just pounding on those. All right, first of all, verse 1 says, imitate me just as I also imitate Christ. Now, he follows a couple of verses that aren't going to come up on the screen. In the previous chapter, verses 31 and 33 of the last chapter, Paul says, therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. That's one thing he does, glorify God. And then in verse 33, he says, just as I also please all men in all things, not seeking my own profit, but the profit of many, that they may be saved. That's the other part. One is to glorify God. Paul's other motive was to bless as many people as possible at the cost of his own pleasure. And so the very next verse, even though it's separated by a chapter heading, says, imitate me just as I also imitate Christ. so do those things that bring glory to God and are good for the most people, even if it means being sacrificial for yourself, because that's imitating what Christ would do. So here's a good question. He says, imitate me just as I also imitate Christ. Can we say that? Could we say to people, imitate me because I'm imitating Christ? You should be able to, absolutely. Now, any given moment, we might be like, oh, well, you know, don't do as I do as I say. But the way we should be living our lives is in such a way that people could look at our lives and know what Christ looks like by looking at our lives. And so the goal for us is to do that. And Paul says, look, I'm not telling you to start saying this, but I'm telling you that I've learned, Paul was not perfect. Paul was absolutely not perfect because he was human just like the rest of us. However, he lived his life in such a way to where that those who were following him could imitate Christ by looking at him as a good example. And that's how we got to try to live our lives as well. And so that's the easy part. Now I'm just jumping on landmines. All right. It says, now I praise you, brethren, that you remember me in all things and keep the traditions just as I delivered them to you. Now I want to emphasize that word tradition just for a moment, because it is a misused and often misunderstood word in churches. We are of a church that tries not to be traditional in anything. There's a whole movement of churches and church thought that says the traditional style of worship and of clerical, what's the word I'm looking for? Liturgical type churches are full of so much tradition that they've lost the relational aspects of their Christianity. They've lost touch with just talking to God and talking plain to one another, that kind of thing. And so we shun tradition many times. But the word tradition here in this case, Paul is using, and you have to understand that what do we say? We don't use tradition. We look at what the Word says. We don't do church tradition or what people told us according to our religion. We see what the Word says. Well, guess what? The Corinthians didn't have 1 Corinthians until Paul wrote this, right? So he's saying, when I was there, I taught you some things, and I handed you some things from up close. That's what the word tradition here literally means. In the Greek, it says to hand off something at close range. It carries the ideas like those who are running in a marathon, or not a marathon, but a relay race, have the baton, and one hands it to the other one, and it's handed off at close range so that the next generation of church people could carry on the tradition that was handed to them through the Apostle Paul. So he says, that's what I'm praising you for, is you're doing a great job, he says, of taking the traditions or keeping the traditions just as I delivered them to you. And then he goes into beyond this, and those traditions hopefully are doing what we said back in the last chapter, glorifying God, doing things that are not for selfish motive. There's a whole underlying theme, and we're going to find it today, about submission and about authority and about submission to authority. And so Paul begins this whole theme of submission to authority by saying, thank you for doing what I ask you to do so far. But I want you to know, I'm just going to teach on this a minute, he says. But I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of every woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. Now, I just stepped over one landmine there and got on the Christ part, right? All right, let me just talk about it here for a minute. I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ. That's an easy one. Every man's head is Christ. Now, the word for man there is not anthropos. Anthropos, from which we get anthropology and other words like that, is the generic word for mankind. In this case, it is not the mankind word, but it's actually the word that would be translated as male or man, adult man, not a child, or a married person. They're called interchangeable terms. Unfortunately, in Greek, as precise of a language as it is, there is not a distinction in language, in words, between the word man and the word husband. And there's no distinction in Greek between the word for woman and the word for wife. So often, whether he's talking about a person individually or whether he's talking about something that has to do with a marital relationship has to be found from the context. So as we look at that, you always got to look and see what kind of man is he talking about here. He's talking about the head of every male, but more specifically, every husband is Christ. Now, why would you use the husband aspect of that word that also means male or man? Not mailman, but male or man. The reason why is because, again, this is about authority and submission. Should every man submit to Christ? Yeah, that's the whole idea. That's the deal. When you call him Lord, then men, we are to be submissive to the Lord in all things. Now, it's a little, where we get into trouble is when we start going into the next part, and it's like, wives, be submissive to your own husbands. Now, that's easier to have a little fight about because us men don't always submit to Christ when we expect our wives to submit to us. That's where we get into trouble, right, ladies? So, if your husbands acted like Christ, it would be easier to submit to that, wouldn't it? Now, notice I'm not using the word obey in any of this. Now, an aspect of submission is obedience. But I'm not saying, hey, women, obey men. That is not what it says here. It does say there is a section about wives submitting to their own husbands, and I really like Pastor Pete's example or definition of that. To submit means to come under. Did I say that right? Sub meaning under. And support it. To come under the mission and support. Yeah. There you go. So to support the mission is to come under the mission. And certainly we want to come under the authority of Christ and support the mission of Christ. And so he goes on to this next part and says, I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ. That's easy. The head of the woman is the man. Now, if you go, what? Women aren't to be submitted to just men, and I believe from all my studies, it is true, women are not to submit to men, even though it says that here. But again, I believe the context indicates that wives are to submit to their own husbands, as it says in another passage of Scripture, as the husband submits as unto the Lord, so that you don't have a two-headed monster. You have a marriage, and it's a unity in that. Now, I'm not teaching on husband and wife relationships this morning necessarily, and I don't have time to fully develop all of that thought. Just trust me that if you live your life and your marriage according to God's plan, it will work for you. And if you really bristle at the idea of having to listen to or submit to your husband, we could spend more time at another time on passages that specifically talk about that. But just remember that if you cannot submit to your husband's authority under Christ, can you expect your husband to submit to the authority of Christ in his life? So things to think about in that. Also, what we're not saying here. We're not saying here that women are second-class citizens. Right? Whenever, amen. Give me an amen, women. In no way is this to imply this in any way. Because this is not a mental examination. It is not a capability examination. It has nothing to do with the ability to lead or not. It has nothing to do with giftings that women or men might or might not have. This chapter has everything to do with God-given authority. Whenever I went into the military, I went in as Airman Basic. That's E1 for those of you in other branches. And you know what I'm talking about. Some of you went in as an E2 or E3 because you went to ROTC first, not me. I went in as Airman Basic Goodner, AB. That means I don't even get a stripe. E1 doesn't even get a stripe. You don't get one stripe until you're at least an E2. So that means everybody's your boss. You're submitted to everybody. Nobody is not. So I know what it's like to submit. That doesn't mean I wasn't smarter than the next guy. It doesn't mean I am not a better leader than the guy who's over me with one stripe or two stripes or whatever. It just means that I had the responsibility to submit voluntarily, come under the authority of the United States Air Force and those officers and non-commissioned officers that are established over me. Those of you who have served time in the military understand this concept very well, that you submit to the rank, not to the person. And so for every wife who has trouble submitting to her husband, I submit to you, you are not submitting to him. You submit to Christ by submitting to the authority structure that Christ set up. And in that, you are praised by your God for doing the right thing, whether he's doing the right thing or not. So I hope you didn't hear me say, blah, 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 submit to men, blah, blah, blah. Because that is not what I said. All right. Thank you, all three of you. All right. Now, the head of every man is Christ, the head of the woman is a man, or in this case, the head of the head of the wife is the husband, and the head of Christ is God. Wait a minute, I thought Jesus was God. Yeah, he is. But he proceeded forth from the Father, which is the definition of being Father, is that which proceeds forth of you becomes Son. See, in eternity past, Christ proceeded forth from the Father, and he is the Son. And just by that definition, the author of the book is greater than the word that it is spoken, at least greater in the sense of authority structure. Now, the word is what the author will be judged by, but the word itself is subject, is probably a better word, not less than, but subject to that which spoke it, and that is the author. So Christ even subjects himself to the Father, though he is God incarnate. And so just as Christ, our example, submits himself, though he's God, and thought it not robbery to be equal with God, so us men need to also submit to Christ. And in the relationship of marriage, wives to their husbands, children to their parents, employees to their employers, and so forth. And if you focus on that one thing because you really have issues with your husband, you have got to pray and say, Lord, would you take away the blinders? Would you take away the fire? Would you take away the heat that is overcoming my thought processes? And let me understand that when I submit myself to God-given authority on the earth, I am not submitting to any person who is a failure. I'm not submitting to anyone who is abusive. I am submitting myself to Christ. And having said the word abuse, by the way, just want to throw this in there, it's not in the text today, but if you're talking about a husband and wife relationship and the wife is being abused, especially physically, you need to get out of that marriage. Okay? We're not talking about abuse here. We're not talking about someone being submitted to abuse. We're talking about a voluntary submission to the authority of Christ and what he's done in our lives. So, there's that. All right. So, we're going to move on. Verse 4 says, every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonors his head. He says, but when a woman who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered dishonors her head, for that is one and the same as if she were shaved. So he begins to talk about authority in the church setting and visible signs of authority. And he says, basically, guys, if you're praying, would you take your hats off? Okay, that's what he's saying. If you're Jewish, take the little robe thingy off your head, whatever you call that. I mean, that's not very pastorally and scientific method there, but whatever your head covering is, he says, take it off. Why? Because the Jews to this day still wear a yarmulke when they pray. They make you put a yarmulke on when you go to the Wailing Wall. I walked around at the Wailing Wall when I went to Jerusalem last year, and I refused to pray. You know why? Because I am a free Gentile under the authority of Christ who has taken away the veil of separation between me and God. Christ himself is my go-between, my high priest, and he's the one who teaches us through the Apostle Paul here that when we pray, our prayers go directly to God, and I don't need a yarmulke to cover my head. The symbol of the yarmulke or a hat on while I pray is some kind of barrier between me and God that Jesus himself took away. And Paul said right here, don't do it. Even though the Jewish custom was to do that, he says we're in the New Testament now and there's a new way. And so every time, men, you take your hat off when it's time to pray, you do that as an act of worship. You do that as an act of recognizing your authority in Christ to be able to pray directly to God. And he says that this is what God has done for anthropos, for humanity, for the human beings. And that is why he's done that. Now, how does that relate to the woman on earth? In this case, he says, every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonors his head. Why? Because he's made you free from that. He's made you free from the separation between you and God. He says, but every woman who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered, dishonors her head. For that is one of the same as if she were shaved. Now, why is there a double standard there? Why did the women have to have their head covered? Well, first of all, in that culture, it was common to have the head covering as a normal thing, not unlike the Muslim faith today where women cover their head and lots more. But the idea still is the same of covering the head. But he says there is a lot of Gentile folks out there that don't cover their heads at all. A lot of women out there that are getting saved from the Gentile churches that are not head-covering women. But he says it's okay because God has given a natural hair covering called your hair. Your hair is the glory. And he goes on to speak about those things here. He says, says verse 7, he says, "For a man indeed ought not to cover his head, since he is in the image and glory of God, but the woman is the glory of man." By the way, are us men always just glorifying to God? Not sometimes, right? But we were made in the image of God. I want to take you from verse 7 now to Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. Speaks of this. He says, "Then God said," talking about himself, he said, "God said, let us," by the way, very interesting that God, the singular God, said us. That's just a clue of the Trinity, again, in the Old Testament. "And God said, let us make man in our image." Everybody say image. That means like picture. That means it looks like us. So we human beings are made in the image of God. Now, when he says man here, this is the generic form. This is not the males. Now, let's not make males in our image, but rather mankind in our image. "Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man, or mankind, in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. So whether you're male or female, all of us are created in the image of God. But who was created first? Adam. Adam was the first man. And so God said it was not good for man to be alone. And so he created woman. But instead of just creating her as a separate being, he took woman from the side of, he took a rib. Now, I feel it. You know, I just broke my ribs 5 weeks ago today. I feel this, you know. But God did surgery on Adam, took a rib, and from the rib formed a woman. And as someone so appropriately said, he did not take a piece of the foot bone so that he would trample over the woman, nor did he take a piece of his head bone so that she would dominate him. But rather from his side, near his heart, I guess this side, for near his heart so that he would love her, cherish her, and keep her close. And so in the beginning, God made man and woman, especially the man and woman marriage scenario, to be an equal, co-equal persons. But the woman, as the help made meet for Adam or made appropriate for Adam, was taken from his side. Adam himself being the first of God's creations in that respect. So you flash forward then back here to 1 Corinthians chapter 11 as Paul's referring to that. In verse 7 again says, "For a man indeed ought not to cover his head, since he is in the image of the glory of God. But a woman is the glory of man." And what do you mean by that? I like being called glory. If I was a better job of being glorifying God, that would be a better compliment for my wife. And I say, "You compliment. You're my glory. You just make me look good." And that's a fact. Let me just say that for a second. She's not here. She probably won't bother to listen to this message. But let me tell you, she makes me look good. I miss her when she's not here. I had Bible study Wednesday night at my house, and I was like, "Man, I wish my wife was here. I hate having Bible study because she just makes me look good. She just helps me relate to people better. She talks to people. She ministers to people. She prays for people. She makes us as a ministry team look really good. And we are a team because we're married, because we are one. And but we are not a two-headed monster. So hopefully my wife will come down and next week and be able to straighten us all out and tell you that we live in a beautiful marriage that is mutually equal before God. And yet we understand the concept of authority, that there can only be one head to a body. If the two of us become one flesh, we might have four legs, but you can still only have one head and one authority. And so the husband becomes that, not the man. The male doesn't become the authority. The husband does. There's a difference between gender and authority or office, you see. And it's the office, if you will, or authority structure of husband that is to be the head of the wife, as opposed to men being subject to women. So I want to be very careful about that as I talk into a very modern world that only understands that men and women are equal, that women have been supposedly put down and degraded, and they have for generation after generation, cross-culturally throughout human history. Women have suffered abuses, have been treated as second-class or third-class citizens, continues to this day. That is not the way of Christ. And to abuse women in that way is not of Christ. The Christianity has done more to elevate the status of women than any other faith and continues to do so. But as he elevates the status of women above any other culture in the world, does Christianity, Christ still expects an authority structure that he sets up. And that's what we find here as we go. And so he says, the man is not from woman, but the woman from man, verse 8, and then verse 9, nor was man created for the woman, but the woman for man. Gee, that sounds kind of arrogant. Hey, God set it up. He said, dude, you mess up by yourself. You need a wife. I mean, come on. There are things that don't go well at my house this week because my wife's not here. I guarantee you I didn't do any laundry. Not that I think women need to do all the laundry, because I often do the dishes and my wife don't. But she is a help meet for me. She keeps me grounded. She cautions me and says, whenever I'm getting my big mouth moving and she's afraid of what I'm going to say next. I need my wife, and she does me good. And so that's what you find here, April was created for Steve because he needed her, basically is my transcript of verse 9. Verse 10 says, for this reason, the woman ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. What do you mean, because of the angels? Because of the angels means that angels are higher in power and ability, than much superior than us human beings are. And yet they are under the authority of God. And in the same way, women are angels. Let me just throw that out. It's an easy one. Women are just angels. Ladies are angels. But they are to be an authority under the structure just like God has. Do angels do anything outside the authority of God? What happens when they do? They get a new name. What do they call them? Devils, demons. That's right. So angels never do anything outside the authority of God who sends it down. And so he's saying that in this case, we need that ladies, whenever they, the hair example in verse 10, he says, for a woman ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. Let's see. I skipped some verses, didn't I? Okay. Did I? I think I read it at least. But I'm going to come back to some verses, Roberta, so just hang with me, girl. Thank you. You're doing a great job today. Love to hear you worship today, too. Nevertheless, verse 11 says, nevertheless, neither is man independent of woman, nor woman independent of man in the Lord. For as woman came from man, even so man comes through woman, but all things are from God. So he's saying, hey, you guys, if you want to get too uppity here, watch out. Remember, your mama was a woman. Your mama had authority over you, and you better learn how to do things right. The first teacher of righteousness and morality is mom, so don't disrespect the woman. Verse 12, for as woman came from man, I read that. Verse 13, judge amongst yourselves, is it proper for a woman to pray to God with her head uncovered? So according to tradition, according to the idea of what he just laid down there, then there's an authority structure that basically says no. He set up an authority structure. He says, but if a woman has long hair, it is a glory to her, for her hair is given to her for a covering. There actually are some churches today, very few, you have to look hard to find them, but they'll have a little covering, head covering for the women when they pray in church. It's kind of also the tradition where women wear hats in church, the big fancy hat, men take your hat off, but the ladies wear the big hat, and very nice, and it's kind of become a traditional cultural thing. But the idea is this same idea of covering the head in church. Well, let me tell you that God gave you hair. And so, ladies, you don't have to wear a hat in church. And you don't have to cover your head with some kind of head covering. God gave you hair. And that is the glory of you, and God gave it to you to be your glory. No matter what its condition, even if you have to color it, it's more glorious if you do sometimes, and sometimes it's just like, look at that glorious head of gray hair if you're brave enough to do it. So I decided that me and Rob are not going to color our hair, are we, Rob? We're going to keep it just like God gave it to us because I respect how hard you ladies work on your hair. Says verse 14 says, does not even nature itself teach you that if a man has long hair, it is a dishonor to him? But if a woman has long hair, it is a glory to her, for hair is given to her as a covering. Now, if you just stop there, if Paul stopped there, then we'd have all the ammunition we needed 40 years ago to blast them hippies. Am I all right? It's a shame for a man to have long hair. And then you get to go to churches that measure how long is long. Mm-hmm. How long is long anyway? Was it really short? Is it like in Bible college where they made sure it didn't touch our ears? Didn't touch the collar? No facial hair for us in Bible college because that was just not the way we did things back in the day. They tried to model it after the military. I got news for you. Jesus did not have that kind of haircut. I don't think Jesus had long hair either. I really don't. I don't think he had long, long hair, but I'm pretty sure he didn't have a military cut either, because that's what the Romans looked like. And the Romans were dominating Israel at that time. And I'm pretty sure that the hairdo of the day for the Jews was not going to be to copy their captors. And so that was the beginning of eyes being opened to myself and these ideas of the outward appearance things being more important than the issues of the heart. So let's not talk about hair coverings and hats and whether women should take their hat off, whether or not women should wear a hat in church or coverings or how long your hair is or any of that nonsense. That really is the outward appearance stuff that doesn't matter. It matters is whether or not we understand the authority of Christ and coming under His authority. And he wraps that up in this last verse here where he says, but if anyone seems to be contentious, which is a... basically, literally, from the Greek, means fond of strife. In other words, if this issue about hair bothers you that bad, he says, we have no such custom, nor do the churches of God. So basically, Paul says this whole thing about women and hairdos, and men in long hair, and short hair, and hair for covering, and hats, and all this stuff. And he says, but at the end of the day, he says, if anybody wants to have a big issue about it, that's not a big deal. It's not a big deal. If you come from a culture where long hair is cool, he says, it's really not what the natural realm of the Jewish and Roman era that they were in at the time teaches. The natural world taught men had short hair, women had long hair. He says, if you go do ministry in a part of the world where it is normal for men to have long hair and for women to have their boobs exposed, hello? There are places in the world like that. I just woke some people up, I know. There are cultures like that around the world. And in those cases where maybe men have long hair and the women don't have anything covering up here, they think they're modest because they're covered down here. And who are you as a missionary to go in and tell them how wrong they are right off the bat, rather to teach them about Christ and to teach that morality in different cultures does not always look the same. Christ teaches women and men as well, but especially the ladies because they're the fairer sex and we men are visually stimulated. He says to dress modestly. Why? Because you don't want to be a stumbling block to your brother. That's why. You don't want to be out there shaking it and getting it, you know. You don't want to be doing that because you're causing your brother to stumble. That makes sense, right? But he says they do not define in the Bible necklines, skirt lines, whether or not your arms could be uncovered, whether or not women should wear gloves, whether or not you should wear the hijab, whether or not you cover up really all but your eyes, or whether or not a decent looking thing for you is a skirt to here in mid-thigh instead of a miniskirt. So you see, the Bible does not get into nitpicking details to define what morality is. He just says, be moral. He doesn't define what modesty is, because he just says, be modest. And the reason why is because cultures do change. Things do change. Now, if you're leading the culture with how fast can you make your skirt line rise up, you might be in trouble. You're being immodest, perhaps. But if 100 years ago, literally 100 to 110 years ago, the culture was that dresses go all the way to your ankle, and you start wearing a dress now that's up to here, are you sinning? Have you lost your morality? We would say that's ridiculous in our age. 110, 115 years ago, if your neckline was any lower than this, you were showing too much skin. If you didn't have sleeves that went all the way down to your elbows, even living in Florida in the 1890s, women were completely covered up. Man, we would be like, that's ridiculous. Am I right, ladies? That's ridiculous. That is a cultural norm for women that does not apply today, and you are not sinning because you don't live up according to the dress standards of the 1890s. But we still know what too much is, don't we? We still know, well, I won't go any farther than that. We know. However, customs change, but the tradition that he talks about at the beginning of the chapter does not change. The truth of God does not change, but the cultural things may change. The truth of tradition handed down by the prophets does not change. The word of God does not change, but the cultural practices can change. And so Paul says, thank you for keeping the traditions as I delivered to you in verse 2, but in verse 16 says, we have no such custom. If anybody wants to make an issue and say, dude, I'm a rock star, I have long hair. Now, in this church, we know one guy in particular that wears his hair that way, don't we? You know why I never make an issue of it? Because of this verse. He would have never fit in the churches I grew up in. Do I want to be such cookie-cutter Christians that if a guy walks in with long hair, that somehow that's got to be an issue? That somehow he's got to feel uncomfortable? Oh, look, there's Ray on the back. Hey, Ray, how you doing, buddy? I forgot he's got his in a ponytail, so I'm not, you know, I don't mean to call you out, but I love you and I love your hair long. It's cool. And according to this verse, it's cool. Right? Am I right? That's what it says. And so we are to be under the authority structure of God, and sometimes the things that we do with our hair or our hats are symbols of our willingness to be under authority. But if those issues become a contentious issue, he says, hey, it's not a deal. It's not a big deal. It's not a deal breaker here, dude. Everybody is welcome. And so the last thing I would like to cover in this is I want to jump back into a landmine I just jumped right over. And that is back to verses 4 and 5. And I'm going to start with verse 4 again, and then I'm going to get to some of those outlying scriptures I want to get to. Verse 4, every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonors his head. So let's forget talking about hair and coverings for a second. Let's look at the word pray and prophesy. Pray means that he's talking to a church. It's called the church at Corinth. And so it's assumed that he's talking to a corporate setting of believers like I'm talking to you today, as if he were there. He wrote a letter, but he wrote the letter to be read to the church in a corporate setting, or in church, if you will. And in that setting, he says, every person praying in church or prophesying in church, having his head covered, dishonors his head. But he says it's not unusual for people to pray in church. It's not unusual for people to prophesy in church. Now we need to define the word prophecy. For the typical way you think of prophecy is what? Anybody shout it out? Predicting the future. That's the number one way that American church, perhaps beyond that, will define the word prophecy, is foretelling the future. Now, did prophets in the Old Testament foretell the future? Many, many, many times. But if you go back and read what the prophets said, inevitably, every single time you will find at the beginning of their message or somewhere in the related story, pretty quickly you will get to these words or something very similar. Thus saith the Lord. Thus saith the Lord. Now, that's the old English way of saying it, but it sure carries some authority, doesn't it? Thus saith the Lord. In other words, this is what the Lord says. And then they begin to speak. That is what a prophet does. this is not a nonprofit organization, despite what we say about your giving. Why? Because we have a prophet in the house, and it's me. Now, I do not foretell the future. I'm not that kind of prophet. But I am the kind of prophet who says, thus saith the Lord. In other words, I have a message from the Lord for you this week. I got something from God that I want to share with you this week. As I'm reading the Word and teaching, which is another gift of the Spirit that we'll learn about very soon in the next couple of chapters, also there is a gift of prophecy where the prophet says, thus saith the Lord. Now, in the Old Testament, sometimes thus saith the Lord was, hey, future stuff is going to happen this way. But sometimes thus saith the Lord was, hey, get your act right because God's going to get you if you don't. That was some of the Old Testament message. And some of that Old Testament message was God loves you and he longs for you. And he, you know, this was the message of God in the Old Testament prophets. But the message uniformly is always, thus saith the Lord, whether it tells the future or not. Does that make sense? That's what a prophet does, is tells what something from the Lord. So if you keep that in mind, I'm just going to use the word preach. I'm going to take the word prophesy out of the way because it gets confusing with foretelling the future. So prophesy is to preach. Preach meaning I'm going to speak to you something the Lord gave me using His Word as a guideline that will tell me that I'm keeping that straight. How do you know you heard from the Lord? A lot of people that think they hear from God are in a loony bin. You know what I mean? How do we know that you're not crazy? Because the Word that the Lord gave me lines up with His Scriptures here, and that's I'm going to preach those Scriptures or what the Lord gave me for today to preach based on His Scriptures. Does that make sense? All right, so He says, when you preach, when a man preaches or prays in church, he should not have his head covered. But every woman who prays in church or preaches in church, her head should be uncovered. Or her head should not be uncovered. I was like, whoa, roll that back, what? He says, when the women preach, and I'm using in my quotes in church because it doesn't specifically say in church, but I believe that's the context of which the apostle is using here. When a woman prays in church, she should have her head covered. When she preaches in church, she should have her head covered. Now, how many people like me will say, hey, I didn't grow up in that kind of church. We didn't have no women preachers in the churches I grew up in. You're afraid to put your hand up. It's okay. I got mine up. Way up. We didn't do no women preachers. Uh-uh. Why? Because it was based on some scriptures that I have just a few minutes to share with you. And I'm going to start in 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 12, where Paul says, I do not permit a woman to teach or to have authority over a man, but to be in silence. For Adam was formed first, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman, being deceived, fell into transgression. So he says that I do not permit a woman or wife, perhaps, to teach or have authority, back to the authority issue again, over a man. Well, if you say, well, women need to keep silent in the church, and they can't teach, and they can't, you know, preach. Oh, it doesn't say preach. It says teach, doesn't it? Do you know that teaching is a separate gift of the Spirit? Prophecy is a separate gift of the Spirit? So therefore, preaching and teaching are two different things. Sometimes they happen simultaneously, but they are two separate things. So Paul says, I do not permit a woman to teach or have authority over a man. Does that mean a woman cannot teach? Oops, call the women back from children's ministry. Paul said you can't do that. It says, I do not permit a woman to teach or to have authority over a man. In other words, you will not be raised up in a position higher than the man because that's God's authority structure that He laid down. May not be comfortable or happy, but it does exist. Now, let me show you some examples of how this works. Peggy's in the audience this morning. I don't want to draw undue attention to her because I know how she loves attention as well. But I have asked her, through Pastor Mike, to teach classes for us for the 101, 201, 301, 401 classes and so forth. That teaching doctrine, by the way, teaching implies authority. It implies doctrinal teaching is what it implies. He says you're not allowed to take authority doctrinally. But if I take the teaching or authority that God has given me and I give that body of work to her or any other woman and she teaches that faithfully, that is not what's being talked about here because that becomes the covering, if you will. The authority of the pastor signed off on what she's teaching is the authority that Paul's talking about with hair and all that kind of stuff later. the pastoral authority is there, even so that means that she is not wrong for teaching. You guys can go to a class at a woman's teaching if it is under the authority of the God-given structure of the church. And so that's one thing. Now, notice the difference between teach. Teach implies doctrinal authority. It does not mean preach or prophesy. And it does not have anything to do with the office of bishop. Now, the office of bishop is what I am. We call it pastor in this country. But pastor means shepherd. And that implies the same thing. The preacher is the one who preaches, but hopefully the preacher is also the pastor or shepherd or bishop of the church. And that is what he says. If you want the office of a bishop, then you have to follow these criteria that are laid out. But he says lots of people have the ability to preach, but are not necessarily in the office of preacher, or as we call it in the United States, or bishop, as it's also understood. So I want to show you next New Testament examples of that. Acts chapter 2, verses 14 through 18 says, "But Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them," this is on the day of Pentecost, "Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words, for these are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel." And he begins to quote Joel, who's prophesying of a day where the Holy Spirit would be poured out and the church will be created. And he quotes and says this, "And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Your sons will prophesy. Your young men shall see..." Did I skip anything? Did I? What did I skip? "Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy." Whew, we don't understand what prophecy is, so it's okay. We'll let that one go. Oh, wait a minute. Prophesy means to thus saith the Lord. Prophesy means to preach. Whoa. They predicted in the Old Testament that New Testament believer women would be preaching. Buddy, that was a hard pill for me to swallow. It wasn't the way I was raised. It was against everything I was raised, based on that scripture about women not taking the authority of teaching doctrine to other men. But this isn't teaching doctrine, this is preaching. There's a difference between establishing a doctrinal truth and being the authoritative spiritual authority on that, and being able to say, "God spoke to my heart something, can I just share that with you?" There's a big difference. To be able to preach what God said, "I have a message from the Lord for you," as opposed to a doctrinal authority. You may see that as being similar, and they are, but there is a definite difference between the authority structure of teaching and of doctrine and preaching the word. And here it says, "Your sons and your daughters will preach." And if you're not sure if that's really what that means, then let's go to Acts chapter 21, verses 8 and 9. Well into the New Testament church, moving right along in the New Testament age, after Christ has gone back to heaven, and after the day of Pentecost, in Acts chapter 21, verses 8 and 9, it says, "On the next day, we who were Paul's companions departed and came to Caesarea, and entered the house of Philip the evangelist, who was one of the seven, and stayed with him. Now this man had four virgin daughters who prophesied." What does prophesy mean? Preach. Now, they may have also told the future, but these were the preaching kind. How do I know? Because the next thing we see is, "As we stayed many days, a certain prophet male named Agabus came down from Judea. And when he had come, he took Paul..." This is not on the scripture, but he begins to prophesy, ties a belt around Paul and says, "This is what's going to happen to you." In other words, you're going to go bound into Jerusalem. This is about to happen. So Agabus, the prophet, began to prophesy in the foretelling the future kind, which we don't see a lot in church today, foretelling the future, because, well, simple. If you're wrong, it's going to be real obvious. Okay? But it is in the New Testament church of people foretelling the future, and he foretold Paul's imprisonment and was correct. But just before him, the writer of the scriptures, the Lord saw to it that credit was given to the four virgin daughters of Philip, who were also prophets, but they were the, thus saith the Lord, preaching, apparently, type of prophets, because they otherwise would have maybe told the future for him as well. So we see there that there's four virgin daughters that also preached there. Now, There are 10 women expressly titled as prophetesses in the Bible. Some would argue that number. I won't go through all of them, but some of the examples was Miriam, who is the sister of Moses, who prophesied. Two men. Huldah, which was Isaiah's wife, who he went into his wife. He called his wife a prophetess. Noah, there's a name. Deborah, great example. Deborah in the Old Testament was not only a prophetess, she was also a judge of Israel. So she was not only a woman preacher in a very male-dominated society, she was also an office holder, a political office holder as a woman, which is also very unheard of in those times. It's not completely unheard of, but very not common. And because there was no kings in those days, the judges were the highest authority in the land of Israel at that time. They settled disputes, they were political, and they were also spiritual. And so she, Deborah, was a preacher and an authority structure. And that she's the first woman, I don't know, president maybe or whatever, shall we say. Anna, in the New Testament, prophesied about the Jesus was born in the New Testament. And then the four daughters of Philip here we talk about. And so the conclusion of all that is that women are really not second-class citizens at all. But in the Church of Jesus Christ, there is even a place for women to actually take the mic and do what I'm doing now, preaching. Now, I'm doing a lot of teaching in my preaching, but there is room for women to be able to say, thus saith the Lord, and not be shamed, and not be saying, you can't do that, and not have anybody hopefully say, hey, that happens, I'm out of here. I'm going to run for the door. You better get out of my way. Hey, please don't have that attitude. I had that attitude. I was wrong. There are limits. I believe the Bible does put restrictions on senior pastoral leadership for women. I believe that he certainly puts limits on the ability to authoritatively write and produce doctrine authoritatively to men. But the door is wide open to women preachers, which is what everybody labels and hates, those women preachers. I got news for you. There are women preachers that the sons and your daughters will prophesy that God has raised, and how many women have been frustrated and unable to preach the word the Lord has given them because of not understanding what the word of the Lord has said. Now, you may disagree with many things I've said in this doctrine. I still had to preach it, and I had to do my best in the hour that I had, or less, 45 minutes. And that's not an exhaustive, authoritative study on this. But hopefully you've been given enough to understand the difference between teaching and preaching, the difference between prophecy and foretelling the future, the difference between a women preacher and a senior pastor or bishop, the difference between teaching and preaching. But let's close with just a couple of great verses here. What are those last two? Did you get the last two up there? I got a Galatians and one of the two, I forget. All right, I'm going to read the Galatians 3:26 through 29. As we close, as soon as I find it, he says, "For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek." Listen to this. "There's neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. There's neither male nor female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus." And I also want to hear from the words of Jesus himself. Do you have that one in, was it Matthew? Mark. Mark chapter 12, verses 23 through 25. Jesus' own words. 12, verses 23 through 25. "Therefore, in the resurrection," they're asking Jesus this gotcha question, talking about this woman who's had many, many husbands, and which one is her official husband after they die. He says, "Therefore, in the resurrection, when they rise up, whose wife will she be? For all seven had her as a wife." Jesus answered and said to them, "Are you not therefore mistaken, because you do not know the Scriptures nor the power of God? For when they rise from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like the angels in heaven." In other words, there will not be gender issues in heaven. There will not be authority structures of wife and husband in heaven. When you get married, it is until death do us part, not forever. Now, you may look at your wife with loving eyes, and you may say, "Honey, I will love you forever." even to eternity, I will always love you. And that's great. And that you can do that. In fact, maybe you should do that. But she's not going to be your wife after you're dead in the afterlife. Now, you can be great friends, but you're not going to be able to say, hey, woman, run fetch me a beer, will you? Yes, sir. My woman obeys me. Ain't going to be none of that stuff. It shouldn't be none of that stuff here, right? It sure ain't going to be none of that over there. Jesus himself made sure of that. And then Paul reiterates the same Paul that said all those other troubling scriptures we covered today. By the way, don't shoot the messenger, all right? He also pointed out there is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither bond nor free, neither male nor female, but all are one in Christ. So that's a good place to leave off, don't you think, today? What is our appropriate response to that? This message was not about men and women. It wasn't about hair or hats. It was about what? Authority of Christ and the willingness of his people to let the word of God be the final authority in everything that we do. And I have one request of you personally as your pastor. There is going to be a day soon, I don't know when, next several weeks, next several months, I'm not sure, that I'm going to schedule someone that is not a man to preach. Because God has called her to ministry, has given her a gift of prophecy just like Deborah, just like the four virgin daughters of Philip, and just like the prophet Joel said would be those who would sons and daughters prophesy. She's not going to get to be the pastor of the authority bishop of the church. She's not going to teach new doctrine for you, and if she does, I'll correct it. But she is going to have a message from God, thus saith the Lord. Now, when we do that, if you can't stand that and everything I showed you biblically today doesn't ring true, then take a day off, I guess, but don't leave the church. But I ask you to consider that, and there will be 20 different people will have 20 variations on the teaching I gave you today, okay? Can I acknowledge that? Can we agree? And there may be times when good Christians will agree to disagree on some things. But I can do only one thing, and that is the right thing that I believe the Lord has showed me to do. And in the course of that, I do not want to chain up and fetter the will and work of the Lord in the earth by me trying to decide what's okay and what's not based on other people's church backgrounds that are way too many for me to keep up with. Okay? We're going to go with the Word of God. So for those of you who are very uncomfortable with the idea of a woman preacher, may I remind you, I came from that group too. And there are limitations as to what the Bible does say about these things of authority, but it's there. And so your spiritual authority today, if you call this your church, if you call me your pastor, is saying this is the best I understand it as the Lord has revealed it from the Word of God. This is the Word of the Lord for today. There's your preach. Okay? All right. That doesn't mean you have to agree with me, but we still have to act in love, don't we? Amen. All right. Well, let's talk to the Lord about authority and then let's be dismissed. By the way, I'm just going to have to say this now while I still have your attention. There will be a play practice right after 1 o'clock. At 1 o'clock, please don't miss it if you're in that. And for those who are planning for the citywide party we're having for the Star Trek event, that will also happen very short right over here. As soon as we get done, we'll be out of here and out for the day. But let's pray and think about the things of the Lord today. Father, we just pray that you would teach us the authority structure of Christ and the kingdom of God. And I pray, Lord, that we would be submitted to Christ in all things, whether we're male or female, whether we're Jewish or Gentile, whether we're bond or free, God, that we would all submit unto the God-given authority in our life as unto Christ, and that that would bring glory to your name. And that, Lord, having submitted ourselves, Lord, you said, those who humble themselves shall be exalted, but those who rise up in arrogance shall be abased. And so we thank you, Lord, for the words of the Lord today, the Word of God. And though, Lord, it may not have been a great we're all going to heaven and we're going tonight, kind of a shouting meeting. It may not have been a real automatic amen getter kind of a message. God, we still honor your word as it's presented. We won't skip any of it. We won't gloss over any of it, Father, but we'll try our best to understand what the word of the Lord is as you speak to our hearts about authority structures. Thank you, Lord, that you love all of us and that we are precious in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen. Stand, if you will, for the blessing as I send you out. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you. May he lift up his countenance upon you as his facial expression of happiness and give you peace. For you are blessed in the city. You're blessed in the field. You're blessed when you come and when you go. And if the Lord is on your side, who shall you fear? For who is like the Lord?
Nobody.
Go on submission this week. God bless you.